Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Brian Kleplin. I'm the Dean of the Graduate School and Research here at Western Carolina University. I'd like to welcome you to our live stream 3-minute thesis competition, better known as our 3MT. This competition provides the opportunity for graduate students to promote their research or project, further develop communication and job interview skills, and for the winners to earn a tuition award and a cash award and represent WCU the Regional Conference of Southern Graduate Schools 3MT competition. Joining me today is our Vice Provost, Dr. Carol Burton, who will be viewing the 3MT presentation with us and announcing the award winners. Dr. Burton, would you like to welcome our participants and live stream viewers?
Thank you so much, Dean Klippel. It is an honor for me to welcome our graduate student participants, our judges, friends, and family members. This 3-minute thesis competition is an opportunity for us to learn about the research findings over some of our best and brightest graduate students here at Western Carolina under the tutelage of our faculty members. Their projects are increasing our knowledge, and their presentations will enable us to learn about the positive impacts that their research is having on the environment, the health and wellness of people, and the continued economic development of our region. I'm honored to be here today, and I wish everyone, good luck, and please enjoy the presentations.
Thank you, Dr. Burton. Dr. Joy Bowers-Campbell, our Associate Dean of the Graduate School, is joining us as well. Joy is going to provide us with an overview of the 3-minute thesis competition and exactly what we are going to experience during today's live stream event. Dr. Bowers-Campbell, the floor is yours.
Thanks, Brian. Welcome, everyone. Created at the University of Queensland, Australia, the 3MT competition provides graduate students the opportunity to develop their professional presentation and research communication skills. This is an opportunity for graduate students to showcase their graduate thesis, disquisition, project, or business plan in a 3-minute presentation geared to a general audience using only one static slide. In past years, students presented to a live audience in the University Center Theater. However, for the past 2 years, students submitted recorded videos and their slides. Let me introduce our judges. Thank you so much, judges, for your willingness to serve. Casey Cooper, who is the CEO of Cherokee Indian Hospital and a member of Western Carolina University's Board of Trustees. Our faculty judges are Amanda Storm, who is an assistant professor in biology, Amy Putnam, who is an assistant professor in nursing, Megan Woody, also an assistant professor in nursing, Jackson Diesel, an assistant professor from health sciences, Dr. Frank West, assistant professor of chemistry and physics, and Dr. Jessica Kirby, who's an assistant professor in the health sciences. This year, we received 22 videos for our competition. These videos were viewed and scored by a preliminary judging panel, and the top 10 videos were chosen to move on to today's live stream event. Each video will be viewed and scored today by a panel of judges. After viewing all the videos, the judges determine the first and second place winners. The final award, however, the People's Choice Award, is decided by you, the viewers. As each video plays, you will see a link to use to vote for your favorite presenter. Please vote. Brian, back to you.
Before we get started, I want to acknowledge and thank people who have worked tirelessly to ensure the success of the 3MT competition, despite the obstacles presented by COVID-19. Dr. Joy Bowers-Campbell, our Associate Dean here in the Graduate School staff members, and Jacob Henshaw, thanks to each of you. And a special thank you to Sam Wallace for his leadership in creating and managing this live stream event, and to the entire WCU marketing team who helped promote this live stream event through the web and social media site. I also want to acknowledge a special thank you to the Graduate Student Association who generously provided funds for the cash awards this year. Is everybody ready? Here we go. Our first competitor is J.B. Bost, who is a graduate student in our Master of Arts in English program. And the presentation is titled, Towards a Better First Year Composition Experience. J.B.?
Very few courses could be considered as quintessential to the university experience as English 101 and 202. Whereas some students can escape without having to take college algebra, others don't have to take a foreign language credit. Everybody has to take writing. So for the past semester, I've been research assistant to the Works program, which is writing, rhetoric, and critical studies. And I've been researching how to improve student retention rates. Retention defined herein as any positive choice a student makes to continue their education to the point of graduation. I've been looking at the successes and failures of different programs at universities and community colleges comparable to ours, as well as how ours differs from them. And the first thing that became immediately obvious was class size. According to the CCCC and the WPA, both groups which go over 101 and 202, what goes into them, they suggest that class size never exceed 20 students per professor, and ideally it'd be 15 or under. For reference, Western Carolina has a class size of 20 currently, and that's down this semester from 23 previously. This is important because professors that teach 101 and 202 are seeing about 80 students per semester. And when you're teaching a process-based approach to writing, which is pre-writing, writing, revision, and editing, that's a lot of words that professor is fielding per week. That's a Tolstoy's worth of words that they have to give meaningful feedback to. And universities' programs are showing that whenever the class size drops, the student success goes up, and as does the faculty's view of their workplace as an equitable environment, which itself reaps benefits back to the students and their retention. Another thing that other programs are doing that we should really be taking note of is they're using technology to their advantage and technology to the students' advantage to alleviate some of their labor, such as putting lectures online and on-demand accessible videos. In fact, the use of videos is showing to be really important in student feedback and to their success. And it's important that if we attempt to experiment with any of these ideas, that we also be prepared to harvest data that we can share that either prove that it works or shows that it doesn't work. A lot of these ideas are still young in their development, so the more data points that we can get in articles and out there in the academic field, the better. The better it's going to be for students, for the professors, and for all other university stakeholders. Thank you.
Thank you, JB. Everyone who's viewing, you saw the link for the vote, and after each presentation, we'll present that link again, so please vote for your People's Choice favorite winner. Thank you, JB. Next up is Emily Deem, who is a Master of Science student in our biology program. Emily's presentation is titled Extraction Efficiency Testing of Degraded Bone Samples, Comparing Four Extraction Methods and Use in Downstream Massively Parallel Sequencing Applications. Emily?
You may have heard of investigative genetic genealogy, or IGG, associated with the Golden State Killer's arrest in 2018. This new method has become a rapidly popular tool in forensics for solving cold cases. Not only can IGG be used to identify perpetrators of a crime, as with the Golden State Killer, it can also be used to identify the remains of missing people. Today, there are more than 13,000 cold cases involving unidentified persons in the United States. The critical first step in employing IGG is to extract enough DNA from your samples in order to successfully amplify and sequence the DNA for identification purposes. For my project, I'm focusing on DNA extraction from bone samples. DNA extraction is arguably the most important step in DNA analysis. Now, bone presents an interesting dilemma. The reason that DNA can persist in bones for an extremely long time is also the reason that the DNA is hard to extract. The calcified matrix in bones holds DNA tightly, so DNA extraction methods need to be tough enough to release the DNA from the bone, after we get into this powder form like you see here, but gentle enough to not break down the very fragile DNA. DNA is also very sensitive to contamination, which is why I'm wearing this stylish protective gear down here. In general, commercial forensic extraction methods aim for longer strands of DNA, which isn't always available in cold case samples where skeletal remains are exposed to harsh environments that degrade DNA. Specifically for IgG, very short strands are more useful. This is where we got the idea to use extraction methods from the field of ancient DNA. Scientists in this field are able to recover DNA from samples that are a million years old. Which brings me to my study question. Are ancient DNA or forensic DNA extraction methods more appropriate for cold case bone samples when using techniques for identification such as IgG? For my project, I'm using bone samples from WCU's Human Skeletal Collection and other sources. I'm going to implement two forensic and two ancient extraction protocols for comparison. The forensic methods are proprietary commercial kits, and the ancient methods were created and published by ancient DNA scientists. Once I extract the DNA, I'm going to analyze the amount and the quality of DNA that I get from all the samples and compare across methods to see which performed the best. This would be the method that recovers the most short pieces of DNA and the most DNA overall. Since ancient DNA extraction methods are able to recover DNA from highly degraded samples, I would expect them to work well with samples that are much younger. Yet, I performed a preliminary study over the summer, which is one of the forensic and one of the ancient protocols in a small amount of bone samples. Both methods produced similar results, which was surprising, so I'm excited to see if that trend continues with more protocols and samples. I hope that my work contributes to knowledge of forensic techniques for identifying skeletal remains and solving cold cases.
Thank you, Emily. Next up is Nicholas Fazzello. Nicholas is pursuing a Master of Science degree in our Communication Sciences and Disorders program. Nicholas's presentation is titled Reviewing a Framework for Concealable Stigma in Communication Disorders, Addressing Adverse Outcomes and Promoting Inclusion. Nicholas?
Hello, I'm going to be presenting on a poster that I've prepared for the American Speech Language Hearing Association. So as a speech language pathologist in training, I understand how important it is to understand or try to understand the experiences of isolation from patients with communication disorders, which by nature are considered concealable stigmatized identities. And with that, we have a lot of internalization, which is the process by which attitudes, beliefs, values, and standards of others are integrated into one schema of the self. And it's really related to a lot of negative outcomes, both related to the disorder itself and general global mental and physical health. So we don't want that to be happening. So we need to be able to pick up and identify these stressors in the environment and within the self. For this study, we conducted a scoping review, and we decided to do this so that we can further promote a type of systematic review that is really learnable and digestible for clinical speech language pathologists and people within CSD. So with that, we identified 31 articles after teasing through seemingly thousands of articles. Most of them were experimental with survey type close behind, and most of them considered fluency disorders with hearing loss closely behind. Some of the common findings were related to identity management, so the decision to disclose or not to disclose. And with that, we found that a lot of times people were motivated to disclose not for themselves, but so that their listeners felt more comfortable. And they did that because when you're having a conversation, you're picking up on cues from others, and you're using that to inform how effective you are, right, as an interactant in the conversation. A big part of concealable stigma is that you lose authenticity because you're constantly monitoring the situation and you're not being true to yourself at all times. So we really hope that with this type of research, we can expand the diversity of the disorders that are involved within these types of researches. And we also hope that this type of systematic review is one that is really widely adopted by speech-language pathologists who are in pursuit of practicing evidence-based practices.
Thank you, Nicholas. Next up is Emily Gaddy. Emily is pursuing a Master of Art in our English program, and her presentation is titled A Closer Look at Africa in Charles Dickens' Bleak House. Emily?
Hello, my name is Emily Gaddy, and this is my three-minute thesis presentation about A Closer Look at Africa in Charles Dickens' novel Bleak House, specifically focusing on the question, can Africa be separated from its resources and from the idea of charity? So Bleak House is set entirely in England. There are no characters from any foreign place, and yet Africa is mentioned almost 30 times over the course of the novel, and a specific place is mentioned about 11 times as well. But still, with all of this information, we don't know much about Africa. We just know that it's a place that deserves charity and that there's all these people working to improve Africa. But we don't really know anything about Africa, actually, in this novel. So by reading Bleak House, we're able to get a glimpse, tiny little glimpse, of how people in 19th century England viewed Africa, especially by paying close attention to their ideas of charity in relation to Africa and African resources. All right, so we're given these glimpses by paying close attention to a character named Mrs. Jellyby. So Mrs. Jellyby is the matriarch of the Jellyby family, all right? And she's portrayed as this philanthropist who only cares about her work in Africa and improving Africa, so much so that she lets her family go to financial and physical ruin, right? Her daughter even says that she hates Africa at one point. Mrs. Jellyby, her idea of charity in Africa is she wants 200 families from England to move to Africa to educate the native people and to work at cultivating coffee and sending that coffee back to England, right? So she's getting something out of this. It's not just charity for the sake of charity and helping people out. It's what can you do for me? All right. So Africa is never described in detail. Throughout all of this novel, it's almost 800 pages, and you never really get a description of Africa. You've got all of these people working for like charity for Africa, charity for all these other places, but you're never given a look at this other country, at why they might need charity, at what could be a possible reason that this country would want to help them. But no, we're led to believe that it is resources and this idea that charity is something to be admired and looked at greatly. All right, so we never hear from an African character, right? There's no descriptions of people in Africa going about their daily lives. There's no discussion about if Africa really needs help. We never hear from an African character about this. And yet the people of Africa are not given a choice. Africa is viewed as a place that cannot be separated from the idea of charity and from the resources that it can give. Thank you.
Thank you, Emily. Next up is Kyle Rosh. Kyle is pursuing a Master of Arts in English, and Carl's presentation is titled Bleak House, Mirrors as Criticism. Kyle?
Charles Dickens uses mirrors and vision as vehicles for social commentary in his novel Bleak House. The novel centers around a court case that is being drawn out so that the legal system can continue to make money off of it, even though the people of London are suffering because their legal needs are not being met. The two groups that could do something about this, the lawyers and the aristocracy, aren't, and the mirrors show why. Esther, the main character, goes into a lawyer's office because she's involved with one of the cases, and the lawyer says that before you go in, you can look at the looking glass on the wall, but it's not required. This implies that self-reflection, or a conscience, doesn't really matter in one of these circumstances. The aristocracy also have mirrors in their house that have long gaps between use. And even when people do use them, 70-year-olds can come away and not believe that they're old. Dickens makes the argument that we should have a positive influence on our surroundings through Esther. At the school that she first teaches at, she says that the growth of the children around her is reflected onto her as if through a looking glass. This contrasts a would-be philanthropist, Mrs. Jellyby, whose children are neglected and her house is in complete disarray because she's worried about a mission that's on a different continent. When Esther goes to her house, Esther takes care of her kids. The corruption of the system manifests in a slum called Tom All Alone's, and a kid named Joe is a central character in this novel. Joe escapes from the slum and infects Esther with a disease that permanently scars her face. This metaphor continues when someone who is in the legal system doesn't even notice the scars on Esther's face. It's normal. But somebody who is outside of the legal system does. The people in the slum are a cry for help. They're likened to oxen who have been worked to the point of being blind, and they are running into walls. We have a couple of characters that go into the slum and interact with them. Alan Woodcourt, a doctor, goes in and he actually helps out with people. And we know he's a good guy because he does that and he marries Esther. But also we have two different people who are kind of like detectives who go in and they get critical information from people in the slums. So even though they're gross and diseased and unwanted, they're still valuable. Dickens really puts a pin in this cry for help when Joe, as I mentioned before, he dies. And the narrator kind of backs out and he says, "Dear Majesty," and names a bunch of other people. "These people are dying around us every day." So Dickens is challenging you to look in the mirror and then look around you.
Thank you so much, Kyle. Next up is Laura Hannah Sturgill. Laura is pursuing a Master of Social Work degree, and her presentation is titled "Perceptions and Lived Experiences of Black Americans in Funding Funerals and How Do They Impact Bereavement." Laura?
This summer, I conducted a qualitative study that asked, what are the perceptions and lived experiences of Black Americans in funding funerals, and how do they impact bereavement? This study considered what impact, if any, the cost of funerals had on the ability of Black Americans to finish an uncomplicated course of grief. As I considered this question, I completed a literary review and found that Black Americans have a 24% higher mortality rate than white Americans. Funerals are very expensive. The average funeral for an adult in 2019 was $9,000. And Black Americans do report having a higher level of complicated grief symptoms. I encountered a significant barrier in my social media recruitment when individuals posted racist comments on the advertisement. I banned and reported these individuals, of course, and deleted their comments from the page. However, I believe that these comments likely contributed to the difficulties I had in recruitment. My final sample size was 6 participants, and a summary of the research findings is on the slide. Recruitment for participation from marginalized communities requires precautions and planning. Participants reported that the high cost of funerals did hinder their grieving. Discussions about funeral arrangements happened about half of the time in the sample. Insurance plans were considered to be of significant importance, and overwhelmingly, the people wanted others to know how important it was to have a some type of arrangement made ahead of time, whether that's insurance or planning documents, so that the wishes of loved ones could be carried out as they wanted. Funerals are considered a celebration of life and therefore are exceedingly important for the grieving process. And anger did hinder the grieving process for a half of the sample. The takeaways were that it's really important to pre-plan for funerals, and making sure that the expenses are taken care of ahead of time. The lack of financial resources increased anger, which impeded the grieving process for the surviving loved ones. And my main takeaway was the importance of advocating for financial resources for planning funerals in the Black American community in hopes that this might ease the frustrations felt by loved ones and promote a more typical course of grief. Thank you.
Thank you, Laura. Next up is Jacob Lohman. Jacob is pursuing a master's degree in the Higher Education Student Affairs Program. And Jacob's presentation is entitled Student Athlete Identity Exploration and the Effect on Career Maturity. Jacob?
Please look at the two athletes on the top right of the screen. What is running through your mind right now? Do you think of your team's record this season? Maybe your most recent homecoming game? Did you think past the individual's performance on the field? I try to see athletes as holistic students. What are their interests? What major are they? How does being an athlete hinder identity and career development at college? My research has aided me in proposing a model for student athlete identity exploration and foreclosure and the effect on career maturity. When I use the term identity, I am referring to social identities, a person's sense of who they are based on their group memberships, such as race, religion, gender, ability, etc. Identity foreclosure happens when students make commitments to those identities hastily and without exploring alternatives. Student athletes often experience foreclosure because they have limited schedules and are unable to explore different communities and career pathways. Afterwards, they typically have trouble with decision-making, self-actualization, and lower levels of career maturity resulting in burnout, confusion, and poor job satisfaction. If the systemic issue is solved, it may result in larger retention of student athletes and higher levels of self-worth, confidence, and efficacy. My model is a pathway that student athletes may experience concerning their athletic identity and how it relates to their career path while enrolled in college. Pre-athletic identities are precursors to their athletic identity, typically before or when an individual first begins a sport. Once an individual commits to a sport, they start developing a strong and integral athletic identity, which will continue to grow and remain high until the individual retires from the sport. Additionally, students with a solid athletic identity may lose interest or not participate in exploratory activities, so they may not branch out for fear of rejection. Due to lack of exploration, athletes then fall into identity foreclosure. This is defined by students' inability to explore their interests, values, and goals outside of athletics. A student may exit college with these underdeveloped social identities, including gender, sexuality, religion, race, etc. The next step is commitment to a major or program. It is defined by students' premature decision to a major, often without exploring career options adequately before commitment. Later, a student may realize that their career might not fit the individual. Identity foreclosure negatively affects career maturity. That is, how much exploration an individual completes before and during commitment to a career field to see if their personality type fits within the chosen career environment. Often, athletes are unable to change pathways by this point. The final step, graduation and career, is defined by a student finishing their college degree and continuing into their careers. With this research, I conclude that student athletes should explore career options and communities early in their collegiate career, and I hope to improve perceptions of student athletes so that all may view these young adults as more than just a number on a jersey, but as a person. Thank you.
Thank you, Jacob. Next up is Tess Perdue. Tess is pursuing a Master of Arts in English. Tess's presentation is titled Coquetting with Truth, The Erosion of Earnestness in Dickens' Bleak House. Tess?
Thomas Carlyle once said that toying and coquetting with truth was the greatest sin of all. Throughout Victorian literature, a reader can find references to earnestness and its importance, but nowhere more frequently than in the novels of Charles Dickens. The two were contemporaries, if not friends, and Dickens fell into a role of hero worship of Carlyle. In most of his novels, he uses Carlyle's ideas of earnestness and its significance as major plot points, just driving home its importance. And Bleak House is a clear example of this. Throughout the novel, which is almost styled like film noir, characters demonstrate their duplicity, railing against the expectations of Victorian earnestness and truthfulness. But Dickens doesn't let these characters off easily. Characters who hide their true identity have a habit of falling gravely ill or even dying. The two best examples of this are Harold Skimpole and Lady Dedlock. Throughout Bleak House, Harold Skimpole is portrayed as childish and ignorant of adult affairs like money or property. But towards the end of the novel, it's revealed he accepted a bribe and is actually not as childlike as he claims to be. And as a result, he is ostracized by many characters and shortly falls ill and dies. By freeloading off of the goodwill of others and having his duplicitous nature revealed, Harold Skimpole is punished with illness and death. And years before the events of the novel take place, Lady Dedlock had a secret love affair with a man named Captain Hawdon. And she even had a child out of wedlock with him, Esther, who is the main character of the novel. But after giving birth to Esther, she sent her off to live with her sister and married a low-level baronet, Sir Leicester Dedlock. She swore to never let her secret out, but later in the novel, it's revealed by her husband's lawyer, who threatens to let it out. And through a series of events, Lady Dedlock runs from her stately home and eventually perishes by the grave of her lover. She is tortured throughout the novel with the hidden knowledge of her secret love affair, but her mental anguish isn't enough. She meets a brutal, lonely end by the grave of her lover and is punished for keeping her secret from the world and violating the rule of earnestness that was so central to many of Dickens' novels. By reading Bleak House with an eye for deceit and the resulting punishment of characters who are deceitful, the reader gets to know Dickens' own opinions on earnestness, influenced by Thomas Carlyle, and how important earnestness is to the author. But what's a good novel without a little immorality?
Thank you, Tess. Next up is Stephanie Cook. Stephanie is pursuing a Master of Art in our English program, and her presentation is titled HD's Waves, A Modernist Confluence of Literature, Science, and Spirituality. Stephanie?
Hi. I'd like to ask you to take a minute to think about science. What comes to mind? Is all theories and things you think are beyond your understanding? How about spirituality? What comes to mind? Maybe you thought about greater purpose or higher power. Let me ask you this though. Was there any intersect between science and spirituality in your thinking? My guess is not. That's what I thought too. However, I'm here to tell you about a time in our recent history where not only did these two fields intersect, but they did so with great purpose. That time, in literary speak, is referred to as modernism. It took place between roughly the First and Second World Wars, and much of the greater Western world was impacted by the literature that comes from this period. A person may have been in a war, had a family member serving, or been in an impacted country experiencing casualties from wartime atrocities. During this period, death was on people's minds, a lot. And that's where science and spirituality come in. During this modernist period, thinkers from many fields reacting to the death around them began thinking about the meaning of life. Science saw the theory of relativity, which links space with time, telling us that there is no one objective reality, but rather that reality is based on how it's perceived. Religion was also talking about the meaning of life, discovering that perhaps some of science's ideas had applications that could help practitioners explain mortality in more grounded terms. But it is in literature that we saw these concepts blended together most impactfully. As writers of the time grappled with death, reaching out to those opposing realms to describe their thoughts to their readers. Hilda Doolittle, otherwise known as H.D., was a writer connecting these concepts frequently in her works from the period. H.D. used science and religion to elaborate on ideas about life and death, as well as the gray area in between that she was experiencing during the time of heavy bombing in London, known as the Blitz. She felt neither dead or alive, but rather existing in an ethereal middle space. H.D. used the idea of waves to connect all of her thoughts together, relating her positioning in this ether to the tide line of an ocean, the area between land and sea where waves have their greatest impact. With a robust scientific background, she used other waves throughout her writings too as the currency to connect the science to the spiritual as she grappled with loss. Sound waves became an important way for her to immerse her audience in the realities of war with its constant deluge of noise. Light waves and the electromagnetic spectrum represent for HD a way of seeing the world in line with the modernist era where electricity was having its big moment. She plays with color and visibility to talk about the different realms she inhabits. Even Einstein and time make their way into HD's work, as she discusses the wave-like patterns of time and its looping qualities, giving much of her writing a new take on resurrection through relativity. By using waves in her writing, H.G. is able to do something that not many writers of the modernist era could. She links the worlds of science and religion together, creating a larger connection to both her audience and her experiences of reality and death during the Great World Wars. Thank you.
Thank you, Stephanie. Next up is Brandon Wheeler. Brandon is pursuing a Master of Science in Biology, and Brandon's presentation is entitled Morphological and Molecular Analysis of Locusts of the Southern Appalachians. Brandon?
Hello, I'm Brandon Wheeler, and I'm a graduate student in the biology department here at Western Carolina University, and I am studying locusts, also known by the scientific name of the genus Robinia, of the Southern Appalachians. There are quite a suite of Robinia species here in the Southern Appalachians, and I'm really excited to get to study this really beautiful and amazing group. My focal species are clammy locust, Robinia viscosa, and Hartwig's locust, Robinia hartwigii. Robinia hartwigii has been variously treated as a variety of clammy locust and as its own species, but no molecular work has been done to really understand where hartwigii and viscosa have arisen from within the genus and how exactly they're related to each other. They're both really rare, with less than 10 populations in the state, and they're both really difficult to identify in the field. They look almost identical until you're really examining the twigs, where clammy locust has this varnished lacquered look, whereas hartwigii has a kind of dusty appearance due to its sticky glands being on 1 millimeter long stalks. I plan to analyze the genus both molecularly and morphologically. For my molecular analysis, I plan to collect leaves and then extract DNA from those leaves and then sequence that DNA using a restriction site associated DNA sequencing, which will give me a library of nucleotide changes that I can then use to create these evolutionary trees that you're seeing here. And those could either signify that Robinia hartwigii and viscosa are entirely separate, and hartwigii is deserving of elevation to species, or they could be intermixed, and hartwigii could be a hybrid of viscosa with another species of Robinia, or it could just be a different form of viscosa. I will also plan on doing morphological work, which I'll measure different aspects of herbarium specimens of the plants, to get an idea of what different identifying characters we might be missing, and to see if what we're calling different species are really organizing themselves along morphological lines. And I'm really excited to work with these species because they represent very rare parts of the Southern Appalachians and really important part of our distinct heritage of the mountains. It's a really beautiful group that grows in really beautiful places, and I'm excited to really get to the bottom of it. And through my work, we'll have a better understanding of how we can better conserve these species and if they are truly their own species. And we can also identify rates of hybridization and any possible deleterious effects of these small genetic groups. Thank you for your time, and I'm really excited to share my results with you next year.
Thank you, Brandon. That concludes the presentation of our 10 finalists for this year's 3MT competition. I encourage each of you to vote in the People's Choice vote, given the voting link that you've seen after each presentation. We are now going to pause briefly to allow for the compilation of scores by the provost accounting firm of Burton, Starnes, and Schwab. We'll be taking a brief break and returning in just a couple of minutes with the results and presentation of awards. Thanks, everyone. Welcome back, everyone. Thank you for your People's Choice votes. Our judges have conferred, and Vice Provost Burton will announce the winners. Dr. Burton?
Thank you, Dean Klippel. I'm delighted to announce the winners of our 2021 three-minute thesis competition. Before I do, congratulations again to all of you 22 submitters and the 10 finalists. Drum roll, please. The People's Choice Award goes to Nicholas Fasanello. Congratulations, Nicholas. His presentation came to us from the program he's enrolled in, Communication Sciences and Disorders. Our second place winner this year, drum roll again, is Stephanie Cook from English. Stephanie, congratulations. We're excited for your presentation and look forward to hearing more about your work. And our first place and representing Western Carolina University in the United States regional competition in the Conference on Southern Graduate Schools is Emily Deem from Biology. Congratulations, Emily. I want to just take this opportunity to thank everyone for your participation in this event and to congratulate the graduate school on putting on another successful three-minute thesis competition. That wraps up our event. Thanks again to our judges and our viewers, and especially to our participants. See you next year. Go Cats!